The Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation is proud to be back, to be able to host this lecture with a renowned world figure in the person of the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, the former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom and member of the British Parliament. Wow, what a welcome. Do permit me to formally introduce our distinguished speakers for today's lecture. I'd like to welcome Otumba Olufemi Pedro, the former Deputy Governor of Lagos State, representing the President-elect Asiwaju Bola Tinubu. Otumba, as you all know, is a Nigerian economist and, of course, a politician. We'd now like to welcome our host, the Executive Governor of Lagos State, His Excellency Babajide Olusola Sanwo-Olu. But due to some unavoidable circumstances, he is unable to be here today. He has, however, asked the Deputy Governor, Dr. Kadri Obafemi Hamzat, to stand in for him. You're welcome, sir. Next is someone who needs little or no introduction at all. He is none other than His Excellency Chief Emeka Anyoko, CFR, CON, GCVOTC, a Nigerian diplomat of repute, former Secretary General of the Commonwealth. It is also pertinent to mention here that the lecture series has had the privilege of having His Excellency chair one of our earlier lectures. Sir, we appreciate you for accepting to chair this election, and we say thank you and welcome. We also have seated the now Coordinator General of the Foundation, Chief Charles Anyiam-Osigwe. And then, of course, the gentleman of the moment, our keynote speaker, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom and still a serving member of the British Parliament. Also seated is Professor Ehosa Osage, Director General of the Nigerian Institute of International Affairs. From the inception of our lecture series, the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation has always partnered with the NIIA, Nigeria's foremost think tank on foreign affairs. Must say it's been a successful relationship and an amazing journey. Professor Osage is the rapporteur for today's lecture. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, these are our guest personalities and our speakers for the 16th session of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation Lecture Series. Please give them a resounding round of applause. Now, let me very briefly acknowledge some dignitaries with us today. Do bear with me if you're not recognized, as I can't really recognize everybody, but I do want you all to know that everybody here is a VVIP. I'd like to acknowledge the entire Anyiam-Osigwe family. Here present is a grand matriarch of the Anyiam-Osigwe clan, Chief Mrs. Dorothy Chinyere Anyiam-Osigwe, C-O-N. She is the wife of the late great sage of the Anyiam-Osigwe family, in whose honor these lecture series are being held. Ogaramba Diugu. And we normally call her, very fondly, with a lot of love, Mama. Mama has never, and this is the 16th edition, she has never missed a lecture. Mama, you're welcome. Let me now introduce the Anyiam-Osigwe brothers. Chief Chukwuka Anyiam-Osigwe. Chief Anthony Anyiam-Osigwe. I've already introduced the Coordinator General, Chief Charles Anyiam-Osigwe. Chief George Anyiam-Osigwe. Chief Kennedy Anyiam-Osigwe. Chief Raymond Anyiam-Osigwe. And of course, their lovely wives, of which I am one. And of course, some of our children are around too. Thank you. The theme for this year's lecture is Rehumanizing Human Experience, a synopsis of the Anyiam-Osigwe's treatises. A theme so apt with the condition of the human race in today's world. Without much ado, I now invite the chairman of the occasion, His Excellency Chief Emeka Anyoko, to the lectern for his opening remarks.
May I stand on the protocol which has been ably pronounced by the last speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, the Anyiam-Osigwe The Anyiam-Osigwe lecture series are now well-established occasions for acknowledged figures to share with the Nigerian public their experience in managing human affairs. My first words, therefore, must be to thank the Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation for organizing this 16th session, this 16th lecture in the series. I am delighted to welcome our very distinguished lecturer, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, to Nigeria. Mr. Boris Johnson is a great author, a fantastic journalist, and a remarkable British politician and leader. Of the books he has written, I think that perhaps the best known is his biography of Sir Winston Churchill, a foremost British, and some would say world statesman. The title of the book is The Churchill Factor, How One Man Made History. And when it was published in 2014, according to Google Books, the New York Times in the United States of America described it as the best-selling story of how Churchill's eccentric genius shaped not only his world, but our own, referring, of course, to the United States. And here I would like to digress a little with a personal anecdote. In September 1983, when our then president, Alhaji Shehu Shagari of blessed memory, invited me to become Nigeria's foreign minister, he began my first conversation with him in his office with a rebuke. He said to me, 6 months ago, you came down from London to denounce my government. He was, of course, referring to the University of Ibadan alumni lecture, which I had given in March, 6 months earlier, and in which I had criticized the reported corruption in the government and in the Nigerian institutions. Whereupon I said to him, "Sir, I hope that the report you received included my introductory remarks, in which I recalled the saying by Sir Winston Churchill that he made it a rule when abroad not never to criticize the government of his country, but when he was home, he made up for lost time." I dare say that the reaction of the president was exactly like yours, because he laughed. As I said, Mr. Boris Johnson is a fantastic journalist. And this can be attested to by many of those who have over the years read his writings in the British magazine, The Spectator, and also in one of Britain's main newspapers, the Daily Telegraph. In fact, he was, for a while, the editor of The Spectator. His writings, if I may say so, were always forthright, even though some of us might not have agreed with his views all the time. My third description of Mr. Boris Johnson is that he is a remarkable British politician and leader. He has so far, and I use the phrase so far deliberately, he has so far left significant legacies in the history of modern British politics. He was the Prime Minister who, following the decision of the majority of the British people in a national referendum in June 2016, to leave the European Union. He was the prime minister who succeeded, after monumental negotiations, in leading the United Kingdom out of the European Union at the end of January 2020. It was he, therefore, who, in popular parlance, got Brexit done, thereby opening the door for the United Kingdom to a potentially hugely beneficial policy of global Britain. And another remarkable legacy that he left was that as Prime Minister, he led his Conservative Party to its winning the largest parliamentary majority in the United Kingdom in over 30 years. He left that as a real legacy. And having myself, like him, studied classics at the university, I believe that one of the strengths of Boris Johnson's personal political philosophy is that he has taken the advice of the great ancient Roman senator, Marcus Tullius Cicero, who said to his fellow lawmakers, "Let the welfare of the people be the ultimate law." In our contemporary world, where internal and external conflicts abound, where there seems to be the beginning of a revival of the Cold War, a world where massive poverty and lack of sustainable life-supporting facilities continue to be the experience of peoples in most of Africa, Asia, South America, and many island states, a world where the entire global community is facing a cataclysmic threat from climate change. I believe that if we are to effectively pursue the theme of this 16th session of the Anyiam-Osigwe lecture series, namely rehumanizing human experience, consideration of the comprehensive welfare of the people should be the bedrock of policies and actions by politicians and leaders across the world. I thank you.
I'm sure we can all do a lot better than that. Thank you very much, Your Excellency, for that very energetic and informative message on our keynote speaker for today. Thank you. I'd also like to acknowledge some personalities here today. We are deeply honored to have His Excellency, Mr. Peter Obi, former governor of Anambra State and gubernatorial candidate of the Labour Party. You're welcome, sir. Also like to welcome Professor Balaji Akinyemi, former Minister of Foreign Affairs. Mr. Pascal Dozier, founder Diamond Bank and former chairman MTN. Chief Olusegun Osunkaye, CON, former chairman of Nestle PLC. Senator Ben Obi, CON. But now I'd like to invite to the lectern another distinguished personality, the Coordinator General of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation, for his welcome address and notes on the central theme, Chief Charles Anyiam-Osigwe.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I would like to stand on the existing protocols. You are very welcome. Rehumanizing human experience, brief on the central theme, a speech delivered by Charles Anyiam-Osigwe at the 16th session of the Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series on this 27th day of March, 2023. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you to the 16th session of the Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series. As we commence today's proceedings, mention must be made of two very distinguished members of the Board of Trustees of the Foundation who are unavoidably absent. First is Michael Chibuzo Anyiam-Osigwe, whose intellectual prowess immensely assisted in the interpretations and systemization of the fragments of Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe. As the Coordinator General of the Foundation, his coordination, zeal, and passion provided the rudder for the journey thus far. The second person is Peace Maria Anyiam-Osigwe, who doubled as the Chief Executive Officer of the Africa Movie Academy Award. Beyond the AMA project, Peace Anyiam-Osigwe brought her genius into developing the foundation in its diverse dimension of expression as a development organ. With their continued interaction with us, even after death, we draw immense strength from our sustained conversation beyond the mundane in giving improved expression to the foundation to the glory of God. For the purpose of clarity in perspective, it is important to note at the start of the proceedings here today that the lecture series is not just an adventure in intellectual rhapsody. It is not a memorial escapade to glorify an individual. No, it is an adventure within the bounds of the submission of Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe on how we can vastly realize a better world order. It is in this construct that he variously espouses on man as the primary moving force of sentient existence. In his fragments, he avers that man is the center of the universe. It is in this context that he evaluates the primacy of man as the driving wheel of sentient existence and its social order. In the view of Anyiam-Osigwe, in earthbound existence, whether in the development of the sciences, technology, architecture, environment, economics, and economic policy, agriculture, industry, ethical sustainability, man is the organic factor in giving direction and determining the depth of development. While the world is assumed to have vastly improved developmentally, the poverty scale, inequality gap, crisis of poor management of the environment, economic structures of ownership, wealth distribution within the group mind compass, labor and productivity, remains fundamental points of disputations. To what extent can the present inflection of human development be assumed to reflect the optimum capacity devolving from the accessible natural endowment at the behest of humankind? Anyiam-Osigwe notes what he classifies as the disconnect between the physical, tangible infrastructure of social development and harnessing the intangible resources of natural order for sustainable development. Further to his analysis of the potency of man in development efforts and the possibilities at his command, he urges that man must reinvent the meditative capacity and the introspective will to apprehend and explore the wider possibilities above the mundane. At this octave, man explores and applies the enormous resource capacity at the metamaterial realm of consciousness. Anyiam-Osigwe notes that mankind has fundamentally alienated itself from the metaconscious realm in which he apprehends the ether and its maximum metrics for effectively comprehending the higher realm of elevated consciousness. Put in layman terms, and borrowing from St. Paul, by faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. And because we are made in the image and likeness of God, we are co-creators with him. But what are we creating? In his own words, mankind is now beginning to realize that a good number of discoveries in science and technology have in actual fact continued to lure man unrestrained into the hazardous and unsustainable domain of wanton consumerism, environmental degradation, synthetic existence, and sometimes toxic chemistry. Thus, in the view of the sage, with a perverted psyche, laced in a diminished quality of human essence, we are not only losing significantly in terms of moral capital, but also increasingly endangering our natural environment and the resources it harbors. Here, Anyiam-Osigwe emphasizes the moral category as a defining property of the human essence. Drawing from Anyiam-Osigwe's location of man as a manifestation of divine intelligence, the spiritual and moral properties become inherent in the comprehension, apprehension, and definition of the human person. However, Anyiam-Osigwe observes that mankind has allowed the law of the material to overwhelm his spiritual faculties, thus manifesting in a perverted psyche. This materialization of the human psyche is the manifestation of a corrupted personality, which undercuts the apparently mental and social distortion in which man presently manifests himself. Anyiam-Osigwe situates the human person with an identity. This he captures in his assertion that man is a manifestation of divine intelligence. In a further elucidation on man and an identity, Anyiam-Osigwe posits that if man evolves an introspective approach for the purpose of unveiling his authentic identity, he will therein apprehend the divine personality, upon which he can effectively build that understanding of how he ought to live his life. First, man as an attribute of divinity ought to have the capacity to apprehend the esoteric dimension of things and a high moral ground. He will have knowledge of absolute reality. This comes to us when we key into the subliminal domain of introspection and therefore awaken the inherent knowledge locked in the subconscious for a better understanding of the totality of phenomena. phenomena. Now, rehumanizing as the fundamental basis for sustainable development. The existence of poverty and the social disequilibrium that characterizes the present world order is that man has lost contact with the attributes and definitions that qualify him as a human person. In the disconnection of his mental identity from this, from his esoteric being, the human person loses the insight which comes with his intuitive prowess beyond the mundane. This Anyiam-Osigwe captures in his assertion that man is endowed with all the unique attributes by which he is at one at the same time temporal, mortal, transcendental, infinite, and causative. He was created in the image and likeness of the God principality. In the subconscious man, mind of man, the spirit property, is contained knowledge of all forms and all creation. This knowledge is man's natural and inherent endowment, but can only be apprehended by those minds that are able to subject themselves to the discipline of introspection. When the individual loses the potency to be introspective, he is demagnetized from the abundant flow of sophisticated knowledge from the metaconscious mind. Relying largely on the provision of the sense intellect, such a person loses touch with his true and fundamental identity as a manifestation of divine intelligence. He assumes the status of a corrupted personality with a perverted psyche. Going further, Anyiam-Osigwe asserts that a corrupt individual is a demagnetized being and is thus alienated from the spiritual, economic, and socio-political abundance of the cosmic order. Such a person is driven by the quest for material acquisition. His personality is consumed by a psyche of eternal unfulfillment, devoid of any form of contentment. Anyiam-Osigwe argues that personalities tainted or perverted in this dimension are, though human in physical form, subhuman and discarnate beings. With individuals of this definition and identity, the abundance of the universe is mismanaged, and poverty, which has an endemic negative impact on the social whole, becomes prevalent. The corrupted mindset for Anyiam-Osigwe is a deeply altered mindset that is dominated by material consciousness to the extent that it locks out the individual's capacity to transcend perceptible reality and integrate into the realm of the non-material state of the universe in its subatomic dimension. In the view of Anyiam-Osigwe, plagued by all forms of distortions in all aspects of human indulgence, locked in a sea of yawning economic poverty and inequity, fundamentally subjected to eroding of the moral content at the level of the individual and community, and contaminated by a highly diminished spiritual capital, the human person needs to be rehumanized to save the world from infinite regression and the consequence of moral debt and destruction. For Anyiam-Osigwe, whether in the underdeveloped countries or the so-called advanced countries, the question of poverty and development is all-pervading. In his view, while economic poverty is more imminent, the most debilitating social phenomenon is moral poverty or impropriety. He argues that the beginning of economic poverty is the perversion of the moral scale and accepting that octave of dysfunctionality is reordered, the world stands at the ebb of infinite regression. In the 21st century, we are equally confronted with continued poverty despite economic advances. We are confronted with violence and wars across the continents of the world. It is essential that we rehumanize the human experience connected to the divine essence within us for a better and more humane world. While my speech has made efforts to elucidate on the philosophical perspective of Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe at the abstract level of engagement, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, who is our keynote speaker today, will contextualize and define its applicability. His submissions, no doubt, will provide insight on how the puzzles raised by Anyiam-Osigwe can be interrogated and resolved. Therefore, with Right Honorable Boris Johnson as the guest speaker at the 16th session of the Emmanuel Onyechere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series, we trust that the insight conveyed in his delivery will give the world a pointer in resolving the puzzle identified by Anyiam-Osigwe in his philosophical treatises. We welcome everyone to this session, trusting that its delivery will immensely benefit the development of Nigeria, Africa, and the entire world. The topic of discourse today draws enormously from the moral, spiritual dimension of meaning, identity, and authenticity of being, consciousness, and the human person. Therefore, it is vastly captured in all of Anyiam-Osigwe's titles on display in the books at the entrance. The publications on display today include his commentaries on the family, the group mind, introspectionism, among others. You are encouraged to pick up a copy as you go out. Let me conclude by informing that since 1999, Anyiam-Osigwe's work has been subjected to broad intellectual interrogation by academics through various seminars and workshops held locally here in Nigeria and internationally. Drawing from the intellectual validity of his works, in 2012, the Nigerian Philosophical Association gave him a posthumous award as a sage philosopher. Since then, the scope of comparative analysis of his works in tertiary institutions have vastly increased with dissertations submitted on his works at PhD, graduate, and undergraduate levels. Once again, we welcome everyone and wish all of us a most rewarding session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief Charles Anyiam-Osigwe. I'd like to acknowledge Dr. Muiz Banire, Commissioner for Transport, Lagos State. I hope I'm right. Also like to recognize Professor Sunday Ododo, GM CEO National Theatre, representing the Honorable Minister of Information and Culture. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, on the 7th of January, 2023, there was a deafening crash of a fallen tree as it hit the ground. It was said that the great Iroko tree had fallen. The crash was both heard and felt in the Anyiam-Osigwe family compound, as the news of the demise of their only sister, the baby of the house, the Nukwada, Peace Marie, Ogechi Anyiam-Osigwe. MFR was first whispered and then announced. A woman of substance, if there ever was one, a woman of tenacity and strength, a devout Catholic. Peace, formerly called PMO, was a lawyer who found her passion in the African film industry. PMO was a member of the board of trustees of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation. She was founder, CEO, African Film Academy, where she trained thousands of students in different fields of the film industry all over Nigeria and Africa. Founder, CEO of the African Movie Academy Awards, AMA, a globally acclaimed film ceremony, or rather, the Oscars of the African continent. PMO certainly left her footprints in the sands of time. Please, may we all rise and observe a minute's silence in her honor. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May her gentle and great soul rest in peace. Thank you. I'd now like to invite Otumba Olufemi Pedro, former Deputy Governor of Lagos State, representing the President-elect Asiwaju Bola Tinubu, for his remarks.
The host governor, our governor, Governor Babajide Olusola Sanwo-Olu, ably represented here today. By the Deputy Governor, my brother, Dr. Bafemi Kadri. The elder statesman, an indefatigable Nigerian, a great man par excellence, a man we always look up to, who inspires us all the time, particularly with his diction and spoken English, perfectly spoken more than a British man. Chief Emeka Anyaoku, CON. Our guest speaker of today, I feel so highly honored to be standing here with him. Always marvel when I watch him on television. He reminds me of a Nigerian politician, a fighter, but nevertheless, a great prime minister. Right, Honorable Boris Johnson, MP, you are welcome to Nigeria. You are welcome to our beautiful Lagos. I hope you have enough time to spend in Lagos and savor in the beautiful environment. I'm sure the Deputy Governor is here to take you around. The matriarch of the Anyiam-Osigwe family, she Chief Mrs. Dorothy Anyiam-Osigwe, CON. You are welcome, ma. I'm glad to see you here today. I started attending this lecture many, many years ago when I was CEO of the bank, and one of the brothers always makes sure I get my invitation. And I remember you are always there present, and I'm glad you are still alive today to witness such a day. May God grant you many, many more years. Members of the Board of Trustees, very many, many distinguished guests, elder statesmen and women, ladies and gentlemen. Our president-elect, Ashiwa Jibola Metinumbu, would have loved to be here today. In fact, he had personally attended this lecture in the past, and when I was his deputy, he used to send me to represent him. He's a friend of the family, and he sends his greetings. He's unavoidably absent. He asked me to come in here and represent him. Unfortunately, I'm not aware that I'll be giving a welcome address, but I'm glad to have this opportunity. Our president-elect is a man of the people. He's a man who cares about the welfare of all Nigerians. And this is his time to make a great impact in the lives of the people of Nigeria. The subject matter of this lecture is very apt and is something that is dear to his heart. And that's why he called on me, insisted I must be here today to welcome all of you here. Being a former governor of this state, now the president-elect of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, is preparing himself for the great task ahead to take Nigeria to greater heights. We should all be well assured that Nigeria is in good hands. There is actually renewed hope for our country. Just be calm, be confident. Nigeria is on a great journey. Ashiwa Jibola Metinubu is the pilot. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
Thank you very much, sir. Our host governor, who is our next eminent speaker, who promised us a greater Lagos rising. The executive governor of Lagos State, His Excellency Babajide Sanwo-Olu, like we said earlier, is unavoidably absent, but he's ably represented by the deputy governor, Dr. Kadri Olufemi Hamzat. Sir, your remarks.
Former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, MP, the President-elect Federal Republic of Nigeria, Ashiwa Jibola Ahmed Tinubu, ably represented here by Otumba Femi Pedro, Chairman of this occasion, former Secretary General of the Commonwealth, Chief Emeka Anyako, the President Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation, Mama Chief Mrs. Dorothy Chinyere Anyiam-Osigwe, and members of the family, thank you very much for putting this together and sustaining it. Members of the State Executive Council that are here, I've seen Barrister Femi Martins, members of the Diplomatic Corps, the Director General, Nigerian Institute of International Affairs, Professor Egosa Osaye, former Minister of Foreign Affairs, Professor Bolaji Akinyemi, thank you very much, sir. Nice to see you. Chief Dr. Olusegun Oshunkeye, thank you very much, sir. Pascal Gabriel Dozier, thank you very much, sir. And of course, Mr. Peter Obi, former governor of Anambra State, presidential candidate of the Labour Party, thank you very much. Thank you. Dr. Mohit Banere, Senior Advocate of Nigeria. Well, my sister there wanted to make you the commissioner again, but you've been commissioner, so you've been commissioner like 10 years ago. Captains of industry, distinguished invited guests, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to every one of us. Let me start by welcoming you all to this very special occasion in Lagos, which is the 16th session of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series. But let me, on behalf of the good people of Lagos and government of Lagos State, singularly welcome the former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Right Honorable Boris Johnson, to Lagos. I know that you were in Nigeria in August 2017, then as UK Foreign Minister, and visited Maiduguri, Abuja, and Lagos during that time. I have no doubt in my mind that the city that you most likely identify with is Lagos, which is the commercial economic center of Nigeria, and it's what is to Nigeria what London is to United Kingdom, which you meritoriously served for 8 years as mayor. So it's a great pleasure to have you here with us in Lagos as the keynote speaker of this great lecture series. And the theme, which is Rehumanizing Human Experience, is synopsis of Anyiam-Osigwe thesis. There is no doubt you are eminently qualified to deliver this lecture, considering your vast political experience as a member of the United Kingdom Parliament, Mayor of the City of London, Foreign Secretary, and of course Prime Minister over the last two decades. Let me now specifically thank the family for organizing and sustaining this annual lecture series since 1999, and inviting a truly remarkable and eclectic cast of speakers to Nigeria every year as keynote speaker. I must say, over the year, this lecture series has become a very important fixture on Nigeria, at least in Lagos calendar. And it is not far-fetched to say that every year we look forward to who will be the keynote speaker. So I'm sure that Mr. Boris Johnson will not disappoint us. So your beloved father and patriarch of this family has bequeathed to you, and of course to our country, a good name. And it is pleasing to see that all the efforts are on deck to maintaining that interesting and nice legacy. It is especially noteworthy that you are doing this even at a time of mourning, a time where you have recently laid your dearly beloved sister and daughter, peace, Anyiam-Osigwe, a great friend of Lagos State, to rest. May her soul continue to rest in peace. I must say that peace helped Lagos State a lot. She helped us to train thousands of youths in various aspects, filming, cinematography, script writing, and so on and so forth. The patriarch of the family and the inspiration for this lecture series was a man who, during his time on earth, was very much interested in the human psyche and essence, and in the idea that human beings exist within a spiritual context and manifestations and extensions of a divine being, a divine intelligence. He believed that an appreciation of this connection that we have to the spiritual ought to condition us to live lives that are moral and ethical and devoted to the greatest good. However, once we lose this awareness and of connection to this divine intelligence, this brokenness opens up the human psyche to negative and immoral influences like violence, greed, selfishness, dishonesty, and so much more, which then manifests in our communities and in the world as insecurity, poverty, inequality, immorality, and other social ills. The above is a fundamental thesis in the Anyiam-Osigwe philosophical worldview, and this is why the theme of this year's lecture is very apt. Rehumanizing human experience means going back to its first principle, rediscovering or restructuring the connection to the divine. The rehumanizing, this rediscovery, is what will enable us to rise above evil and immorality and to live our lives according to the innate moral codes that we were designed to live by for a just, harmonious, peaceful, and equitable world. quoting from the material made available by the foundation, discussions at these sessions will focus on exploring Anyiam-Osigwe's exposures on reinventing the human essence in its pristine form. It is very timely, especially for us in this country, and it's an issue that we need to debate, especially in a world increasingly afflicted by rising inequality, terrorism, pandemics, rising geopolitical tension, dangerous populism, climate change, and disturbing unpredictability of technological disruption. As the American activist and community organizer Fannie Lou Hamer reminds us, nobody is free until everybody is free. We are all connected as human beings, regardless of what language we speak, or what religion we practice, or what skin color we have, or where in the world we live. Until we are all free from poverty and war and violence, none of us is free. Rehumanizing the human experience is a clearing call and challenge that must be taken up collectively by all of humanity for all of humanity. This holistic, whole of humanity approach is very central to all of the late Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe's philosophical thinking and writings, and it has become an urgent necessity in view of the many protracted challenges being confronted by the world today. I can definitely say from my experience here in Lagos, tackling the coronavirus pandemic, that tackling unprecedented challenges require opening ourselves up to the new level of thinking and that are anchored on the integration of the most noble and moral political, economic, and spiritual principles. That is the only viable way forward for humanity, the only way to guarantee a viable future for all of us. And it is also important for us, as a philosopher once said, the best way to kill the brain is to talk without evidence. And as a people in our country, it is also important that we don't continue to demean our country, always criticizing everything that is done without providing solutions. We will go nowhere if all we see are the negatives, or if all we celebrate are the negatives, and then we leave the good things that we are doing. So on this note, let me once again thank the Osigwe family and the foundation for putting this lecture together, for sustaining it, and for inviting all these good people that are seated here. I thank you for listening, and I look forward to the lecture by our guest lecturer and the deliberation that this event will bring forward. Thank you very much. God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and God bless all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. The moment that we've all been waiting for is almost here, as I invite Chief Kennedy Anyiam-Osigwe to do us the honors of introducing our esteemed keynote speaker for the 16th edition of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series. Chief Kennedy.
The rule is very simple, to introduce the Right Honorable Boris Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests here present. The Right Honorable Boris Johnson, MP, is a champion of democracy, freedom, and free market capitalism. He served as Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, a leader of the Conservative Party, Foreign Secretary, Mayor of London, and a Member of Parliament. Mr. Johnson believes that the shared innovative power of the West will take us all through the ramifications of the Ukraine war and post-COVID shocks, as well as defeat struggling authoritarian regimes. He believes in technology driven by free market democracies will ultimately defeat our biggest challenges on health, science, and global warming. Mr. Johnson is sought after for his illuminating insights on global security, the world economy, and his continued work supporting freedom around the world. Mr. Johnson argues that in the 21st century, countries must be able to deregulate and be as competitive as possible. That is why he successfully campaigned for Brexit, taking back control of the UK, law, making the biggest constitutional change for half a century, and enabling the United Kingdom to generate the fastest vaccine approval in the world today, and the fastest vaccine rollout in Europe. With all the subsequent economic benefits, in addition to his work in politics, he's an award-winning journalist, writer, and editor. Of course, he's been claimed to be very erudite as well as it is on all those areas. He's an author of almost a dozen books from the globally best-selling historical biography of Winston Churchill. The Churchill Factor, to the self-illustrated children's book, The Perils of Pushy Parents. He edited The Spectator magazine for 6 years and has written for dozens of major publications, including most notably London's Daily Telegraph. Mr. Johnson is the kind of politician and visionary thinker who takes risks for the principles of democracy, freedom, and free markets, and stands alongside those fighting against authoritarian regimes. I have the singular honor of introducing Mr. Boris Johnson, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson. Thank you.
Well, thank you very, very much indeed. It's wonderful to be here, Your Highnesses, Excellencies. Can you hear me? Distinguished guests, members of the Anyiam-Osigwe family, and Matriarch Dorothy. It's absolutely wonderful to be here. I'm so excited to be here. I've been looking forward to this speech very, very much. Wonderful, very kind of you to invite me. And listening to the speech has already been so terrific. I feel, I don't know about you, I feel rehumanized already. Don't you? And it's so good to be back in Nigeria after an enforced absence. I had to be prime minister for a long time during COVID. I couldn't get here. Because this is such a wonderful country for us, you don't need Google Translate. We all speak the same language. When you arrive, my flight was very late, but it doesn't matter. When you get here, you don't have jet lag, because the Almighty has brilliantly stationed London and Lagos in the same time zone. You don't even need an adapter plug for your laptop, because Nigeria has had the wisdom to continue to use those classic chunky 3-pin British plugs rather than the weedy EU 2-point kind. And here in Lagos, you can even drink the local Guinness, because this is one of the few cities in the world where you actually brew the inky nectar. Even if I have to admit that Nigerian Guinness seems to be about 10 degrees proof and has a kick that would knock them out in the bars of Dublin. And of course, that's one of the Lagos is the London of Africa, but it's also the Dublin of Africa. Why is Lagos the Dublin of Africa, Mr. Deputy Governor? Because they brew Guinness. And because it's Dublin every decade. That joke needs work. It's Dublin in size, that is. You get my point. And it's a particular honor to be here at the Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation. And I want to pay tribute to the late peace Anyiam-Osigwe, who so sadly died in January. And I think peace was a role model for women in the creative industries and a role model for female leadership around the world. And in the spirit of this lecture series, I want to talk about human potential and the way we unleash human potential, because that is the prime duty of all of us, all of the leaders, all of the teachers, of politicians everywhere. And I believe that that is the same question, that the same puzzle that Emmanuel Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe was revolving. And all my life I've been meditating on this question of human potential. Who has it? We all have it, but how is it distributed? And I began by learning some hard lessons. In my first 18 months of existence, I formed the view that the world revolved around me. And indeed, I probably believed in my infantile narcissism that I had somehow created the world, and that everything and everybody were incidental somehow to my pleasure and benefit. And then, like so many male babies, I experienced a terrible shock. Can you guess what happened? Anybody guess? My sister was born. And I had the first shattering detonation of my egotism and sexism, because it turned out that my sister was actually smarter than me. Or at least she was so quick at reading that she briefly overtook me. I can remember what happened. We're driving along, I think in Somerset, in our Renault 4, and we come to a sign in the road, and my father says, "Kids, what does that sign say?" And I must be more than five, and she's barely four. And I spell out the letters to myself, G-I-V-E-W-A-Y. And I know that if you have an E at the end, then it lengthens the vowel before the consonant, and I deduce that the sign must be indicating the presence of a giveaway, a bit like a driveway. But of course, my sister got it right, and she said, "Give way, give way," which is what people say to me the whole time in the House of Commons, by the way, "give way." And I gave way to her. And in that searing moment, I abandoned all notions of male intellectual superiority. But version of Sid the Sexist from Viz Magazine. Thank you for turning me back on that. And while everybody was laughing at me, a tall girl called Tracy came up, and she must have been only about a year or so older, but she suddenly seemed very big indeed. And I can't remember exactly how Tracy physically proved I was wrong, but in a flash, I was on my bum on the ground, and I remember looking up and seeing this ring of happy faces laughing, and I felt a total twerp, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm very grateful to Tracy, because she taught me that you shouldn't be sexist and you shouldn't generalize about human ability. And I, of course, I did find, like all of us, I found some things easy, but then other children found other things much easier than I did. And I was hopeless at them. I couldn't play the recorder, and I couldn't dribble a ball at football. And I wondered, as we all do, to what extent I had natural aptitudes and skills, and to what extent I was just the product of my parents' energies and the excellence of my teachers. And I started to form a theory about the world based on my own observation that there was skill and aptitude and talent, ability, everywhere. Yes? Pretty much evenly distributed throughout the population. But opportunity was not. There was intelligence everywhere, what you call native wit, but not everybody had the chance to use it or to show it off. And at the age of about 11 or 12, I found the words to express this idea. It was a poem by Thomas Gray called Elegy, written in a country churchyard. And you know this one. Gray is standing there at dusk as the curfew tolls the knell of parting day, the lowing herd winds slowly o'er the lea, and so forth. And he looks at the graves of all these poor, illiterate village folk. And it's written in about 1750, long before universal education. And it occurs to him that they could have been contenders, these ignorant Buckinghamshire peasants. They could have been poets. They could have been statesmen. They could have been tech billionaires. Not they had tech billionaires in 1750 Buckinghamshire, but you know what I mean. They just never had the chance, said Gray wistfully, because no one had taught them to read. And he says, full many a gem of purest ray serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bare, full many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert air. And I think he's right, don't you? The UK has a population of 66 million, Nigeria maybe 200 million growing. How many of our people are able to reach their full potential? And how many of them are like flowers that nobody ever sees? How many talents are there, like jewels lost in the blackness of an undersea cave? And I'll tell you how many I think it is. I think it's a hell of a lot. Millions. Tens of millions. And the job of politicians is to create the conditions in which those people can unleash their potential. Because not only is that morally right, and it's surely right if we care about human development to give everyone the chance to express the talents that the Lord has given them, it's the right way for them to achieve happiness and fulfillment. But it's also, this is the important one, it's also the right thing for the economy. Because what we're seeing everywhere, I think in both our countries, is a colossal waste of human potential. And all my political career, whether as Mayor of London or as Prime Minister, it's been about trying to solve that mystery, unleashing that talent, excavating the gem from the darkened cave, letting people flower. And the phenomenon we've seen in both our countries is that people in search of opportunity have migrated from the countryside to the cities, because that is where the jobs are. And that's why London is the most productive city in the whole of Europe, and that's why Lagos is doubling the whole time. And I'm honored to speak in the presence of the Deputy Governor of Lagos, Dr. Kadri. I hope you won't mind if I try to outline from the point of view of a former Mayor of London what I think are the crucial conditions for allowing talent to bloom and for cities to thrive. And the first and most important, it's got to be safe. You've got to have equality under the law, because that is the foundation of freedom. And of course, I know some of the problems that are faced in some parts of this wonderful country. I know the lives that are sadly being lost. But those bandits, I want to tell you, those bandits, those terrorists can and must and will be defeated. And eventually law and order will prevail. And I want you to know, by the way, that the UK, as ever, stands ready to help. But we in the UK have certainly had our own problems with terrorists in the past. And I'm proud to say now that London is one of the safest big cities in the world. Indeed, the Metropolitan Police are so impartial that they once arrested Prince Andrew himself, the son of our late Queen, when they saw him loitering in the shrubbery of Buckingham Palace. In what you laugh, in what later turned out to be a case of mistaken identity. I thought this was quite funny until a couple of years ago the Met actually fined me in circumstances that I still find almost too painful to describe, simply for standing at my desk in the cabinet room and eating lunch. And for followers of British politics, I want you to know that the fabled birthday cake about which the BBC and the rest of the media fulminated for well over a year remained unseen by me throughout that 20 minutes in its Tupperware box, later to be discovered and consumed by my private secretaries. And look, you know, whatever you may say about that unhappy episode, look on the bright side. Can you imagine the Moscow police arresting Vladimir Putin for having lunch at his desk for 20 minutes? Can you imagine the Chinese police doing the same thing, yes? Doing the same thing to Xi Jinping? Whatever else it shows, that decision, which may have seemed to me to be bizarre, it shows to me that the law is enforced in my country without fear and without favor. And whoever you are, high or low, rich or poor, you will receive the same scrutiny and the same protection in the UK. And that is the first and most crucial freedom and the precondition for economic growth and investment. Freedom under the law, freedom to live your life as you choose within the law, provided you do no harm to others. And the next great freedom, an indispensable freedom, is the right to choose those who govern you and the right to remove them from office. It's called democracy, and it's very precious, and it works, and it's under attack the whole time. Why did Vladimir Putin decide to launch his evil and criminal onslaught on Ukraine, triggering the worst war in Europe for 80 years? Because he could see that the Ukrainians were choosing a different path. They were going towards an open, liberal, democratic system, a different system from the one that he was permitting to the Russian people. And he could see that there was a risk in this for him, and that as Ukraine succeeded and aligned ever more closely with Western democracy, that the Russian people would themselves demand change and that Putin's own position would be under threat. And why, by the way, do you think he miscalculated so badly? Why did he fail to foresee the heroic resistance of the Ukrainians? Why did he get it wrong? And by the way, the Ukrainians are going to win, just so you know. I'm very proud of what the UK did when I was Prime Minister to help them with lethal aid. We were the first major European country to give them serious quantities of lethal weaponry, the shoulder-launched anti-tank missiles in particular. And they helped the Ukrainians to kick Putin's forces out of Kiev, out of the Kiev region, out of Kharkiv, out of Kherson. And I believe that this year, in 2023, they will be able, if Ukraine's friends continue to give them what they need, to kick Putin out of the whole country. But why did he get it wrong? Why did he underestimate the Ukrainians? He's normally thought of as a brilliant chess-like calculator, isn't he, Putin? I'll tell you why. I mean, but he's made a terrible mistake. He's incapacitated about a 25% of Russian military forces. He's running seriously low on ammunition. I'll tell you why he got it wrong. It's precisely because he isn't democratic. It's because he was surrounded by yes men and sycophants, and he didn't have backbenchers like I do or did. Yeah. He didn't have anybody giving him contrary advice. He just had everybody saying, yes, yes, Vladimir. Go right ahead, Vladimir. Of course he got it wrong. And he had no democratic checks and balances. And that's why, in the words of Winston Churchill, democracy is the worst system in the world except for all the others. And let me give you another proof of the value of the democratic system that we both operate in Nigeria, in the UK. Who here has been vaccinated against COVID? Who's been vaccinated? A healthy majority there, I'd say. Virtually everybody. I've been vaccinated, by the way. But who had Sputnik? Right. Who had Sinovac? No disrespect to anybody who used either of those vaccines. But the vaccines that actually worked, that were effective, were made, as it happens, in the liberal free market democracies. The effective, medically effective vaccines. And that was extremely telling, because it's in the liberal free market democracies that the best scientists actually want to live. And you're more likely to produce a genuine scientific breakthrough if you're interested in what shareholders are going to say than if you're worried about what the Politburo is going to say. And that's the third crucial condition for releasing human potential. You need a society that is open. On grounds of religion, yes, or race, or ethnicity, or gender, or sexual orientation. And I can tell you, in London, about 40% of the population is born abroad, including me, by the way. I was born in New York. Very expensive decision it turned out to be, under the American tax system. I had to give it up. But in London, we speak more languages on the streets of London than virtually any city in the world, with the exception of Lagos, where I know hundreds of languages are spoken. And that's why London is such a ferment of creative energy, like Lagos. We have more tech unicorns in the UK than France and Germany and Israel combined. We have one roughly every 2 weeks, a new tech unicorn being born. We have fintech, medtech, edtech, biotech, nanotech, green tech, Aztec, Toltec, Miztec. The whole thing sounds like 15th century Mexico. I pay tribute to the role of Peace Anyiam-Osigwe in setting up the Oscars of Africa. But we have almost as many films made on the streets of London as in Hollywood itself. In fact, I believe that London, Lagos, and Los Angeles are the biggest centers of movie production in the world. So what are the ingredients? Are you following me? You need freedom under the law, security, democracy, openness, and tolerance. But even that is not enough for urban success, given the challenges we face. And to deliver equality of opportunity and to unleash human potential, the state, we all of us have two more giant tasks. I'd like to have the Commissioner for Transport here. I used to be Chairman of Transport for London. You need to allow talent to move. I mean physically move. You need people to be able to move swiftly and affordably, cheaply, from where they live to where they can maximize their talents. Absolutely fundamental. Absolutely fundamental. And it's one of the many blessings of living in London that in 1853, they came up with the idea of putting trains in drains, they called it, trains in tunnels, 1853. So that suddenly millions of people could move underground at high speed, and they didn't have to wait in giant traffic jams of stationary horse-drawn carriages with the dung piling higher and higher on the cobblestones. And today, the mass transit system of London is so efficient that every morning it sucks in millions of people on tubes and trains and buses from far outside the capital, and then every evening it expels them like the digestive tract of a vast undersea cylinderate. And it does it so fast and so efficiently that they get home in time for their children's bath time or for an evening gin and tonic. And that's what we want to do. So, Deputy Governor, Commissioner for Transport, I've spent enough time in Lagos. It's wonderful to be here. But I've spent enough time in Lagos to know that you have the occasional traffic jam. Just a little bit. I mean, it's a sign of dynamism. It's a sign of growth. It's a sign of activity. But it's a barrier to opportunity. It's a barrier to the unleashing of potential. And I know that you are building wonderful mass transit systems and a metro. How's it going? Fantastic. What I want to say to you today, in an absolutely unashamed way, as the former chairman of Transport for London, let's do it together. When I was mayor of London, thank you, Anyiam-Osigwe family. When I was mayor of London, I increased the capacity on the tube by about 30%, and I built Crossrail, the Elizabeth Line, the biggest engineering project in Europe. I know you're doing the first leg, but let's do the rest of it together. Don't do it with the Spanish, don't do it with the French, don't do it with the Chinese. Do it with Transport for London. And I read that you're interested in cable cars, because it's such an amazingly beautiful place. You've got so much water to cross. I'm proud to say that I built a cable car in less than a year across a huge cable car across the river from Greenwich to Victoria Dock, and it's a huge, beautiful thing. And I took Arnold Schwarzenegger up into the cable car, and he looked down on Canning Town. And he said, "Very nice." And he was right. It was absolutely beautiful. And people made fun of me. I promise you, my political opponents in the Labour Party, they made fun of me, and they said I had built a cable car from nowhere to nowhere across the river. But you know what happened? Just a year ago, my successor, the new Labour mayor of London, do you know what he did? He actually moved City Hall so that it could be at the foot of the cable car. He did. He moved City Hall to be at the foot of the cable car. And so, like all those projects, the tube upgrades, Crossrail, all the many things we did, that cable car brought people closer to jobs, closer to opportunity, closer to what we're talking about today, that is closer to allowing them to fulfill themselves, to express that talent that they have, and which is absolutely crucial to their human experience. And finally, what is the most important thing the state can do and must do to unleash potential? Well, think back to that poem I quoted earlier on. "For many a gem of purest ray serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bare, for many a flower born to blush unseen, a waste of sweetness on the desert air." What was the state failing to do in 1750 when Thomas Gray stood over the mouldering graves of the unlettered poor of the village of Stoke Poges in Buckinghamshire? What was it not doing? What's it got to do? The state must educate, or at least the state must insist on education for girls as well as boys, and equal education for both. And I'm proud of the UK system, proud that we have 4 of the 10 best universities in the world, 1 Cambridge College boasting more Nobel Prizes than Russia and China combined. And I, by the way, I want to say how wonderful it is for the UK system that so many brilliant Nigerian, and I know this, you know, it's a fantastic thing for us, so many brilliant Nigerian students choose the UK and continue to do so. But the fact is, and they add massively to our country, but we still have too many British kids who cannot do basic arithmetic at the age of 11, and who leave primary school still not able properly to read and write. And I know that because I've been to see it, here in Nigeria you still have the nihilistic know-nothings of Boko Haram and the Islamic State, and you know, these people who literally believe that books are some sort of sacrilege, and who threaten to kill young girls, main young girls, for wanting to read. And I've got to say to you, that is evil. That is the extinction of human talent and potential. And that, in my view, is the exact opposite of what peace Anyiam-Osigwe stood for, and the opposite of what this conference is all about. And I know how much progress you've made in stamping out those deranged and sexist terrorists, and I'm proud of what the UK has been able to do to help. And I want to end with this thought, that now is the time when the world is so uncertain, when we see free trade breaking down between nations, when barriers are going up, when some nations are disentangling or decoupling from others, now is the time for the UK and Nigeria, two great democracies with so much history in common, to do more together. We should be tackling climate change together. The technology is there. The UK is already one of the world's greatest producers of offshore wind. It's unbelievable. I never believed in it 20 years ago, but we now produce more offshore wind than virtually any other country in the world. We're the Saudi Arabia of offshore wind. Nigeria could be a renewable superpower as well as a massive producer of oil and gas. And we have certainly can share the technology. You've got the technology already. We've certainly got the sun here in Nigeria. Not today, but generally speaking, not in Lagos, I know. But you certainly have a more powerful share of the sun than we have in the UK. And our trade flows are increasing fast. In spite of the pandemic, I looked at the numbers, they're going north fast, and that's a great thing. And we send you all kinds of things to Nigeria, I'm proud to say, from pot noodles. I don't know why we send you pot noodles. To machine tools, but the Nigerian goods are coming back in ever greater value. Not just oil and gas, but thermostats, oscilloscopes, all sorts of high-value products are now coming from Nigeria. And we could do much, much more, and we could achieve much more investment, mutual investment, particularly, just to make a small political point, if we could end exchange controls. That would be a great thing to do. We did it in 1981. We did it in 1981 in the UK. It was the dawn of the UK, under Margaret Thatcher, the UK economic growth and recovery. We could do so much more together. But the greatest triumphs of all are not the imports and the exports, but the synergies between the UK and Nigeria. The actors who are neither exclusively British nor exclusively Nigerian, but somehow both at once. The Nollywood films that are financed in London. The Ed Sheeran songs that he records with Fireboy DML. Does anybody know? You know who Fireboy DML is. The Anglo-Nigerian boxers with the knockout punch. And the knockout punch of the black beer that is neither British nor Nigerian, but somehow both at once. So let's stick up for the ideas that unite us: free trade, free speech, free elections, no matter how difficult they may seem, not just because, or how controversial, not just because they're nice to have, not just because they feel like good things to have, but because those combination of freedoms are demonstrably the best route to long-term prosperity. And let's recognize that our challenges are shared challenges. Whether it's climate change or the instability in the Sahel that triggers both the terrorism and the mass migration that washes up on the shores of the UK, and let's tackle them together. Let's be proud of centuries of common history, from the Nigerians who fought for freedom in Europe, in two world wars, to the security and defense partnership that we in the UK have with Nigeria today. Let's deepen that partnership, and let's do more together to unleash the potential of all the people, of all the people of both our countries. So thank you very much. Here's to Nigeria, UK. Thank you to the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation, and thank you all for your kind attention this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, the Right Honourable Boris Johnson. Thank you so much. That was simply an interesting, engaging, and I hate to use the word, but amazing talk. Thank you very much, sir. We'd now like to invite the rapporteur for today's lecture. He's none other than Professor Ehosa Osagie, the Director General of the Nigerian Institute of International Affairs. Professor Osagie.
Your Excellency, Right Honorable Boris Johnson, we would never forget this day in a hurry. This is the day Parliament came to Marriott Hotel. I'm sure that all of us who have had the opportunity and the privilege to see His Excellency on TV getting all the bashing from the backbenchers have seen the stuff that made him last for as long as he did. And I have also come to realize that if you find people who are in the humanities, especially people who come from the background of the arts and drama and music and especially journalism, they are great, great leaders. You see, the perspectives that you bring to bear are perspectives that come out of the extra perceptory senses that are not so very common to all of us. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Now, I'm particularly excited because today I have returned to the classroom. In 1967, John P. Nettle wrote a little article entitled Bringing the State Back In. And listening very carefully to the former Prime Minister, I can see that there is a new kid in town. That new kid is a re-engineered kid called the state. Because today he brought the state back fully in. And see how that contrasts with the neoliberal orthodoxy that we were taught in the 1980s, that the state should disappear or the state should reduce. But today, he has told us that without security, without education, without security and all of those things, the possibility of developing the human potential would always be close to nil. Now, he also talked about transport. And as he said that, my mind went once to, I was sitting in an audience like this a long time ago, and this was the president of the World Economic Society. And he was telling us, Deputy Governor, I'm sure you would be happy to hear this. He was telling us that there is a future the world has not recognized. And that future belongs to a place he didn't want to let out until he had finished his speech. He said one day, he came by a very vibrant city. And in that city, he was locked in traffic for a long time. It took him close to 6 hours to get from one point to the other. But the vibrancy of what he saw is the lesson that he took away from that city. That it was possible to go to school, to go to hospital, to go to the market, and go to sleep, all in one journey of 6 hours. And he ended up saying that city is Lagos. Because he says, in the Lagos traffic, you will buy any human part that you are looking for. Anything that is essential commodity, you would get on the street. Now, but his lamentation was he hoped we would find in that Lagos a way to sort of put a proper perspective to a different dimension of life that Lagos offers. don't drive the people from the streets, he says. Look for ways of strengthening the capacities that they are telling the world exist in other climes, in other areas. Don't let us always follow the mainstream. I think that's part of the message, you know, that we have heard this morning from the Prime Minister about the essence of transportation. And I'm happy our former Commissioner for Transport is here. You know, that transportation is key, is vital to all that we are doing. I'm also reminded of a Cameroonian anthropologist, Paul Unkwi, who once at another conference said to us, when you people say there's recession in Africa, you don't know the barometer for measuring the health of your economy. There's a place in Lagos, he says, called Oshodi. Oshodi has a bridge from where you can sight human activity. He says the day you go to Oshodi and you don't find those human beings, they know there's recession. But anytime you go to Oshodi and you find the life that goes on there, which is not replicated anywhere else, then recession is far from Nigeria. Now, these are little matters that the state has control over. And I'm particularly excited today that we have brought the state back in. Now, my word from this would, I hope you permit me, I'm going to cite a Chinese proverb. This one says, when we all live together and we all have the opportunities and the potentials that you identified, we find things in our humanity that would also come to block some of us as you identified. Now, these things, we can use the concepts of exploitation, oppression, domination, and so on. But the Chinese say, why is it that human life always entails the bigger fish eating the big fish eating the small fish, and the small fish eating the smaller fish, and the smaller fish eating the smallest fish? Julius Nyerere, the great Mwalimu of Tanzania, had heard this sense, and he said, socialism is not something that you come to because you are poor. Because he says, if, counterfactually speaking, those who are poor were then given the opportunity to be rich, maybe some of us would not even have the air to breathe. Now, that's the essence of humanity. The sharing of prosperity and of productivity that we talk about. The one that will take us from where we are, where the small fish is eating the smaller and the smallest, to a place where, you know, sugar candy mountain flowing with milk and honey. This was in Animal Farm, Morel the sheep, who probably lost the revolution when it came, because Morel was carried away, dreaming about Sugar Candy Mountain. Now, what does Sugar Candy Mountain represent for us? It's a place where there would be no more oppression, where we'd all be free and happy ever after. Now, in the Bible, it talks about the world that will come, where it will be for each according to his need. It is interesting that Karl Marx, the great Karl Marx, and there are many people in this audience today who have the beards that Karl Marx had, and who therefore can appear to be revolutionary. But Karl Marx and the communists of old borrowed that line, hook, line, and sinker from the Bible. Because in a classless society, they say, it will be for each according to his need. Classlessness will come, but we have the agency to bring this about. And I think the whole essence of humankind, going back to the philosophy of Anyiam-Osigwe, must be that who does not work should not eat. But when you have worked, justice requires that you be given your due compensation. Everything that stands between you and your due compensation, therefore, amounts to injustice. As it is in the nation state, so it is in the global stage. It is not for nothing that we all have societies called states that we fall into. The states have the responsibility to make our humanity matter. The state has responsibility to ensure that even the family does not fall apart. What kind of state would allow the family to fall apart where the father has his rights, the mother has her rights, the daughter has her rights, and the son has his rights? If we don't get back to our organic beginnings, and this is the whole thing about the human essence, productivity would not matter. It would be misused opportunity, and we'll continue to live in societies where corruption means that dog would always eat dog. I think this is the essence of what we have heard today. We must be grateful to you. Thank you very much for also being the poet that you are. It is very great. But I will close with Humpty Dumpty. He built a great wall, and Humpty Dumpty had a great fall, and all the great men could not put Humpty Dumpty back together again. We must build our humanity. Thank you very much.
Please, let's give him another round of applause for a job well done. Professor Osigwe, as you were speaking, a quote came to my mind from St. Augustine, a doctor of the church. And St. Augustine believes that a virtuous life is dynamism of love. That he who lives a virtuous life goes towards love, but he who lives a wicked life goes the opposite. Furthermore, loving God means loving one's fellow men, and it denotes never doing any harm to another. For every man that has the right to their own self-value and has the right to live a peaceful life free of any harassment and harm. It just came to mind when you were talking, so I was trying to remember it. Thank you very, very much. I'm sure you all agree that today's event has been a memorable event. The Right Honorable Boris Johnson joins our list of prominent world leaders and figures who have graced our platform and has given the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation lecture series a depth of knowledge and experience that makes, or rather places, the foundation on a pinnacle of success, which we do not take for granted. We're eternally grateful and very appreciative. Thank you, sir. And as a token of our appreciation, the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation will present to our august visitors and speakers a fellowship plaque for their valuable contribution to the foundation. I'd like to call on the chairman of the occasion, Chief Emeka Anyoko, to make the first presentation to our keynote speaker, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson. I'd now like to call on Chief Anthony Anyiam-Osigwe to make the other presentations. The next presentation will be made to Chief Emeka Anyoku.
It is with great honor and deep appreciation that I present this to you on behalf of the Emmanuel Onyenchere Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Foundation. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
The next fellowship plaque is to be presented to His Excellency Baba Jide Sanwo-Olu, the Executive Governor of Lagos State.
Your Excellency, it is with great pleasure that I present this fellowship award to you. We thank you for being here with us.
Thank you very much.
Lagos is a special city for all of us. We've been here for so many years. I went to primary school in Lagos. Even secondary school, so did most of us. So Lagos is home to us. Thank you very much for coming.
The next one is being presented to Professor Erosa Emmanuel Osage.
I'm not used to making speeches, but I'm tempted to make one right now. I didn't see you taking notes when the speeches were being delivered. Your memory must be something else. And he's an erudite scholar. He impressed all of us, didn't he? He summarized it beautifully for all of us. Thank you very much, sir. We're honored to have you as a fellow of the foundation.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we thank you very much for your active participation in today's lecture. I hope you enjoyed the program as I call on Chief Tony Anyiam-Osigwe for the vote of thanks. Before we take the vote of thanks, we'd like the gentlemen on stage to please stand up and come together so we can take a group photograph. Thank you.
Our distinguished honorable speakers, the Right Honorable Boris Johnson, our very special guests on this occasion, the tack you took to address this topic was quite unique. I'm sure
Everybody was surprised the angle at which you came at it by. But it was absolutely fascinating. A wonderful way and a wonderful delivery, and deeply appreciated by all. Thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Emeka Anyaoku, well, what do I say? Where do we start? Is it the language? Is it the achievements over time in life? We thank you very much, sir. You have always been a supporter of this foundation, and you've always accepted our invitation to help. This is not an exception. Thank you very much, sir. Mr. Hamza, the Deputy Governor of Lagos State. Thank you very much. Ably representing our host governor, Governor Sowolu. The cerebral exposure of the Deputy Governor was felt here today. And so Lagos is in very good hands indeed. Thank you very much for coming. Professor Osage, I remember. I am married to a Bini girl, so I shouldn't forget that. Her name is Osage, by the way. Thank you very much. You were very, very good with the repertoire. And I'm sure John Major enjoyed your submissions. Boris Johnson enjoyed your submissions. John Major. Well, by the way, John Major has been our speaker sometime in the past, so pardon my mistake. And Mr. Pedro, you more than ably represented Asiwaju. Thank you for coming. Thank you, all gentlemen. And thank you, our great audience. It's been great having you. I hope you all had fun. We're grateful for your continued support, for sharing, making our time to share these periods with us. Thank you very much.
Your Highnesses, Your Excellencies, members of the Diplomatic Corps and the international community, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we've finally come to the end of the 16th edition of the Osigwe Anyiam-Osigwe Lecture Series. On behalf of the Anyiam-Osigwe family, we want to express our deep gratitude for your being here today, and we do wish you all a very safe trip back to your various destinations. We'd also like to thank our august visitors, and we ask Mr. Boris Johnson that you do visit Nigeria. Spend some time, and I'll personally take you around. Yes. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you all, and have a very good afternoon. Thank you.
The Starship Enterprise, all the bottles.